darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Say your truth.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Crosspoint, and we welcome those that are watching online. We're glad that you're with us today, and we just want to encourage one another in the Lord as we worship, whether we're gathered or whether we're watching online. In the midst of everything that's happening in our world, we need to be encouraged, and we come together and we praise the Lord, and in our praise to Him, we are strengthened and encouraged in our lives as well. I'd like to invite you to please stand, and if you're at home, you can stand at home for prayer, and then please remain standing as we worship the Lord together. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you today for your goodness and your grace in our lives. In the midst of all the turmoil that's going on around us, we are so thankful that we can have confidence that you are with us, you are for us, and Lord, we just come together today to praise you for all that you have done for us and are doing for us. Lord, we pray at this time for our schools, for all the students and their families, for teachers and administrators and board members, all the people that have to make decisions and choices and make adjustments for this school year. We just pray, Lord, that your hand would be upon them and that you would guide and direct them and that this would be a good school year for all the students. Lord, we pray for St. Peter's School in India, Lord, and for all that they're going through right now with COVID and partially shut down and not knowing what they're going to be able to do about busing and all of these things. And we just pray, Lord, that you'd be with Verson and his wife and their board as they prepare for another school year. We just pray that you would guide and direct them. Lord, be with us now in these moments. May your Holy Spirit bring comfort and conviction and joy. And Lord, help us to be able to be pleasing to you. And Lord, as we talk about in the message this morning, that we would be prepared for your coming. We'll give you praise and honor and glory for all that you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Bow at his feet. When you came running, there was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the
to heaven. Why? moment we shall be changed on that day. And one day we'll be free, free indeed, Jesus. One day all the struggles will cease. And one day we'll be glory revealed on that day.
Before you're seated, if you would just take a moment with me, something that we do around here on Sundays, usually at the beginning of the service, if someone has received Christ as their Savior during the week prior, either through the church's ministry or the ministry of someone in the church, we have a salvation celebration. And pre-COVID, that meant all kinds of clapping and high-fiving and all of those kinds of things. We can't do all of that. But last Sunday, right in the middle of my sermon, we celebrated Elijah Rodriguez coming to Christ through the witness of his grandfather, Ernie Martin. Raise your hand, guys. Let's celebrate. Eric, Elijah, and Ernie, God bless you both. Praise the Lord. Okay, you may be seated. They weren't here to appreciate the celebration last Sunday, and so I thought we better do it this morning while they're here. Well, many people through my lifetime anyway, have asked this question, and this question has come to the forefront even more so in recent months. And that question is, is what's happening in our world today, ushering in the end of time and the second coming of Jesus. Some have written articles, some have published blogs and books on the subject, but the truth is this, is what Jesus says in Matthew 24, verse 36, but about that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Now that answer makes people angry. Jesus was used to that. You might say, well, Pastor, how do you know that makes people angry? Because I've received the emails and the phone calls. I've had people walk out of the church because when they realize that we're part of the Wesleyan Church, that in the Wesleyan Church, we believe that Jesus Christ is coming, but you don't have to subscribe to a particular scenario of all the details. The Bible says that even Jesus doesn't know. So if you think that you know when Jesus is coming, you know more than Jesus does. And I don't think that's probably the case. And so that does make people mad because they have it all figured out. But if you read Matthew 24, you will see that people will be living much like they always have. They'll be eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. They'll be working and supervising workers and even be sleeping. He tells us that we must be watching, be ready, and be prepared. Matthew chapter 24, verse 42, it says, therefore, keep watch because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. And then again in verse 44 of Matthew 24, Jesus said, so you also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. In our text today, Jesus tells a parable about a wedding to illustrate being prepared for his coming. We're continuing the sermon series, Jesus Says, and the title of the message is Be Prepared, and our scripture is from Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. I'm not going to read those verses this morning, but I will summarize the parable that he gives. Now, some of Jesus' parables begin with Jesus saying, the kingdom of heaven is like. In other words, Jesus was ushering in the kingdom of God. It's a present thing. The kingdom of God was brought in by Jesus, and we are part of the kingdom of God in this world. But there are also aspects of the kingdom of God that have not happened yet. He says at the beginning of this parable, at that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like. He's indicating that he's continuing what he started in chapter 24, talking about his coming and being ready and being prepared for when he comes again. Just a real quick parenthesis here. About the scripture. When the scriptures were written, they were written without all the verses and chapters in them. And later on, they were added so that we could find particular passages of scripture when we're trying to look up a particular scripture that we might be familiar with. But where do you find that in the entire Bible? So it's been divided off in chapters and verses. But when this was written, it wasn't that way. And so chapter 24 flowed right into chapter 25. And so Jesus is just continuing that same thought when he says, and in that day, the kingdom of God will be like. And he goes on and talks about this wedding scenario. In weddings at that time, after a bride and groom and their families agreed for the couple to be married, they were considered married. They could not break up their relationship without a written divorce. They were married, but they could not yet come together and live together and consummate their marriage at that time. And that period of time was called a betrothal, or they were betrothed. And we're familiar with that from the Christmas story, that Mary and Joseph were betrothed to one another in marriage. They were not yet able to come together, but they had made their promises. You see, in that time, a marriage was not just between a bride and groom, but it was a coming together of families as a whole, and so they had this commitment to each other. And during this betrothal period, the groom would go and prepare a place for he and his bride to live. It could be a room in his father's house. It could be an additional room that's added to his father's house. It could be a house on a parcel of land that his father has given to him for that purpose. And it could take up to a year or even more than a year for this process to take place. And there was a lot of trust that was involved. She had to trust that he was working on their place to live, and he had to trust that she was being faithful to him while he was away. But we're familiar with this also from John chapter 14, where Jesus said to his disciples, "Don't let your heart be troubled. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place, I will come again." It's a reference to this whole marriage scenario of those times. And so when the bridegroom was about ready to come back to get his bride, he would send messengers back to her town or village, wherever she lived, and word would begin to spread that the bridegroom is coming. And there, the unmarried girls or women of that community would come together. They would have lighted torches, and they would come and spend the time between when the call went out that the bridegroom said, "I'm coming," and the time that he actually showed up. They would spend that time with the bride, and they would come with torches. These torches would be long poles with rags wrapped around them, dipped in oil, and then set aflame. And they would come, and they would be with the bride. And the idea was that when the bridegroom came, that they would encircle the bride and groom and walk with them to the wedding celebration. And Jesus tells us here that there were 10 of these virgins that lived in that community, unwed women in her community, and there were 10 in this particular case, and 5 of them were wise, and 5 of them were foolish. The five that were wise because they took additional oil. Not only did they soak their torches into the oil and set them ablaze, but the wise took additional oil along with them in case the flame went out and that they would be prepared when the bridegroom came. The other 5 were foolish because they had their torch and it had oil on it and it was lit and all that, but after a time, if the bridegroom didn't come, the light would go out. It would burn out, and they didn't have any other way to light that. And so the time came, the message came to the community, the bridegroom is coming soon. And so the 5 who were wise, their light had burned out also, but they got rid of the old burned off rags, put fresh rags on, dipped them in the oil that they had brought with them, and lit the flame, and they were ready for the bridegroom to come. But the foolish did not have oil. They didn't bring extra oil along, and their torches also had burned out, and they didn't have the oil that they needed. And so they asked the 5 wise, "Will you give us some of your oil?" And they said, "Well, we can't. We still don't know when the bridegroom's coming. We need to keep our oil so that when he comes, we are prepared for his coming. You're going to have to go and get your own." Well, it was late at night when they discovered this, and they had to go and find oil. Now, there weren't any nearby superstores that were open 24 hours a day, and so they had to go and find someone who sold oil, but they had to wait until they got up in the morning and got their shop open and purchased the oil and come back. Jesus said it was a long time before they came back. Now, I want to just interject here again that oil and fire are both symbols of the Holy Spirit in our lives. These people, that they came with their torches lit, but they didn't keep that power of the Holy Spirit in their lives. They let that go dormant. They were not prepared for Jesus. And so these foolish virgins went to buy oil, but by the time they got back, the procession had already been made to the celebration, and the door was shut, And the keeper of the door, when they knocked to get in, the keeper of the door said, "You're not allowed in here. I don't know who you are." And they were not able to enter because they were not prepared when the groom came to get his bride. Dr. Myron Augsburger, former president of Eastern Mennonite College, said, "Three of the saddest sayings in the parables of Jesus are found here. Our lamps are gone out. The door was shut. And I don't know you." These are the things that these foolish virgins heard because they were not prepared for the bridegroom to come. This parable is a warning to those who follow Jesus to be ready when he comes. Being ready doesn't mean that you know all the different theories about the second coming. Being ready doesn't mean that you know specifically every detail of what you believe about the second coming. What it means is that when Jesus comes again, that we are living in obedience to the Father. That's what the scripture says. We will be doing the Father's will when Jesus returns. Now, for 6 years in the past decade that we just completed, six of those years, we hosted a missional holiness conference here in our building, and we had the theme fanning the flames of a 21st century holiness revival. The idea of that was to realize the necessity of a revival that was needed in the Church of Jesus Christ and a spiritual awakening that was needed in our world. In 2020, it's more evident than ever that we need a spiritual awakening in our nation and around the world. Amen? We will not see a spiritual awakening in the world until we have a spiritual revival in the church. You see, the Spirit doesn't move out in the world among people who don't know Him. He moves on the people who are serving Him, and then as they go out in the power of the Holy Spirit, they influence others, and ultimately culture is influenced, and many people come to Christ and repent of their sins because of the movement of the Holy Spirit within the church. And we need, I'm talking about we Cross Point, and also we the Church of Jesus Christ in the 21st century, we need a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit, a fresh wind in the church, and a fresh cleansing by His presence. And both, we need a fresh oil and we need a fresh fire. We need that as the Church of Jesus Christ. About a week ago, I sent out a message from the pastor to those who are on our email list, and I want to share it with you today. For the first 90-some days after we had to suspend services, I began to send out a message from the pastor every day, and I did that for over 3 months. And then when our state went green, and when Lehigh Valley, rather, went green with the COVID virus, I cut that back, and now I send it out maybe once or twice a week. So last week, probably 8 to 10 days ago, I sent out this message from the pastor. But from my side, it's blind. I don't know who reads it. We send it out to over 100 people, but I don't know who reads it and who doesn't read it. And I believe that this particular message that I sent about 8 to 10 days ago is so important. I want to read it for you today. Now, I'm not assuming, first of all, I'm not assuming that you didn't read it. I'm not assuming that you don't read your Bible. But if what I'm going to read to you is true, we have to assume that the majority of Christians are not reading their Bible. And that's a concern for me as your pastor, and I think it's my responsibility to point that out, to be used by the Holy Spirit to encourage you to read your Bible. Recently, I read a recent survey that indicates that that Bible reading and engagement in the Bible has declined during the pandemic. This is exactly the opposite of what we should be doing. We need God's help and direction more than ever. I've included a paragraph here from the article that I read for you to read about these survey results. And here is a quote from Christianity Today that is actually quoting American Bible Society. American Bible Society released on July 22nd its 10th annual State of the Bible report, which shows cultural trends in the U.S. regarding spirituality and scripture engagement. The report reveals findings from two surveys, one conducted in January 2020 with Barna Group and another this June, that demonstrate the effects of the pandemic on the faith community. The data show that scripture engagement has declined amid the COVID-19 outbreak, and there is a clear relationship between scripture engagement and in-person church participation. And that's the end of the quote from that article. And now I'm going to go on and talk about those two last statements. Here are two powerful truths that impact our lives and the lives of our families that come out of that paragraph. First of all, scripture engagement has declined amid the COVID-19 outbreak. That's the end of quote. The pandemic has extended much further than expected. No one knows when it will end, but we know that it will continue for a while. The lack of scripture engagement can cripple your relationship with Jesus and have a negative impact on your family. Let me encourage you again to download the Bible app on your device and use it daily. They feature reading plans as well as a verse of the day. Even if you read just one verse a day for a year, you will have been impacted by 365 verses. Just one verse and reflect on that during the day. And as you prepare your children to go back to school, in person or virtual, just one verse a day and a brief prayer with them before the day begins can have tremendous benefit. Then the second quote from the article, the statement that is made, there is a clear relationship between scripture engagement and in-person participation. End of that quote. And then I continue in the email. We have endeavored to make sure that Crosspoint is one of the safest public places that you can visit in the Lehigh Valley. If you go to the grocery store, you're safe here. Okay? People of all ages, from under one here right now to over 80, I think we have some right now that are in the room over 80, have safely attended our 45-minute worship services. Of course, if you are sick or highly vulnerable, you should stay home. But in-person worship impacts scripture engagement, which has the benefits that I've already outlined earlier. As your pastor, I want you to know the concern that I have for each of you and your families. Please consider how vital scripture engagement is at all times, and especially during this pandemic. Make sure you are engaged with the scriptures and be aware of how in-person worship helps you to engage with scripture. Our current trials will either drive us away from our faith or draw us closer to our Savior. This is true for the impact on your children and your grandchildren as well. That's the end of that email. Now, if you have already have the habit and the routine of reading from the Bible, pages and paper, that's great. But when I'm recommending the Bible app is for people who don't have that habit, it's easier if you have that app. It'll give you the one verse a day. It'll give you reading plans. And you can even have the device that you're looking at read it to you. Now, you can't get much easier than that. What a great way to be able to start that habit of having scripture engagement every day and to be able to share that with your family. I'm not assuming that certain people are not reading their Bible, but based on the statistics, there are fewer people reading their Bible today than what there were people reading their Bible back in January. And that is a huge problem, especially when we think of Christians. So I'm not trying to chastise you this morning. I'm just sharing my heart with you. It's a major concern for me to think that on my watch as pastor of this church, that scripture reading is declining and scripture engagement is declining, and I don't express anything about it. It's a major concern. And this pandemic has been and continues to be a crucial opportunity to experience a revival. Now, how do we do that? And if you have something to write on, write it down, or this will be on Facebook, YouTube, and our website later today. You can check it out. But these are your action items. These are things that you can do and should do to try to be open to experiencing a revival. The first is pursuing a closer walk with God. If you ever dated someone that you really love, maybe they're your spouse now and you look back and remember dating, remember how you longed to be with him or you longed to be with her? You wanted to hear their voice. You wanted to be with them. I was a student here in Allentown, and my bride-to-be was back in Hanover, Pennsylvania, in York County. It was over 100 miles away, and we weren't able to be together all the time. And when I had a weekend where I could go home, I took every advantage and opportunity to go back home and visit with Jane. And during those times when we couldn't be together, she would write me letters, and I would write letters back to her. A long time ago, on our 25th wedding anniversary, during the weeks that led up to that, we got those old letters out, and we read them to each other each night before we went to sleep. And maybe we need to do that again. But it was the longing of being together and to be able to communicate with one another. And that's what I'm talking about when I say pursuing a closer walk with God. Not assuming a close walk with God, but pursuing a closer walk with God. Making specific, intentional steps that help you to have a closer walk with God. An increased practice of prayer. That's talking to God. If you are in a relationship, you need to communicate. And so when in prayer, you are talking to God. Now, it's okay to say, "Dear God, get rid of this awful virus and keep me and my family safe." Those are good things to pray, but don't make that the only thing, okay? Tell God how much you love him. Tell God how much you appreciate him. Tell God how much you are dependent upon him. Tell him how great he is and how big he is and how wonderful he is, because he is. And so we need to tell him that and to build that relationship. But not only increase practice of prayer, but an intensifying commitment to the Word of God. We talk to God in prayer, and we hear from God, and we listen to God through reading scriptures. And that's communication. Communication is not a one-way street. It's both speaking and listening. And so we need to talk to God more in prayer, and we need to listen to God more through his word, and then seeking a fresh movement in us and among us. Those foolish virgins thought that they had enough time, that, well, the bridegroom is going to come shortly, and so we don't need to take any extra oil. And when the bridegroom came, they weren't prepared. We need to be prepared for his coming. Roger L. Hahn, who was held a variety of positions at Nazarene Theological Seminary in Kansas City, says, "The parable of the 10 virgins provides a most interesting lesson in readiness for the second coming. The problem of the 5 foolish virgins was not that the bridegroom came quickly. Their problem was that he delayed, and they became lackadaisical. Readiness for Christ's return cannot be based on the nearness of that return. Disciples must be ready because they do not know when and cannot know when the Messiah will come." Most of us have heard about the second coming all of our Christian lives. We may have read the books. We may have heard the sermons. We may have read the articles. And, you know, somebody would say, "Well, Look at all these signs. Jesus is coming now, or Jesus is coming in a certain year, or whoops, I miscalculated. It's the next year on that same date that he's coming. You understand what I'm saying? There's been all kinds of prophecy where people are made to think that they know what Jesus said he didn't even know. Okay, we cannot know when Jesus is coming, but we can be prepared for when he comes. And we are prepared for when he comes by doing his will. While we are waiting, we are either growing closer to Jesus or we are drifting further from him. At this part of what seems to be an endless crisis pandemic, looking back over the last 5 months, have we grown closer to the Lord, or are we drifting? If we keep doing what we're doing now, when this is all over and there's some semblance of normalcy to life, will we have drawn closer to the Lord, or will we have drifted further from him? What if, even before the pandemic is over, Jesus returns? Will we be ready? Will we be watching? Will we be prepared? I trust that the answer is yes. At this point, I normally open an invitation to people who do not know Jesus as their Savior and to ask Jesus to be their Savior and to become a follower of Jesus. But today, I want to just leave it right here where it is. I'm talking to the church this morning. I'm talking to Crosspoint. I'm talking to Christians everywhere that are watching online. Are we living in preparedness for Jesus' return? Are we closer now to the Lord than what we were a few months ago? If we keep going in the way we're going, will we be closer to the Lord when the pandemic is over? Will we be ready when Jesus comes? My concern is what those statistics say is true. Many Christians are drifting further and further from Jesus. And if that's true of us, any of us, my concern right now, we pray and ask God to help us get back to what we know we ought to be doing, or start doing what we ought to be doing, so that we are prepared. Is coming. Shall we pray? Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for your great grace. We thank you that we know that our blessed hope is the coming of Jesus Christ. Help us, Lord, to be prepared. Help us to be pursuing a closer relationship with you. Help us to be increasing our time in prayer. Help us to increase our commitment to reading the Word of God. Help us to be open to a fresh movement of the Holy Spirit, that you might move in a way that we've never seen in our lives. May we be open to your movement, for you to do a new thing, a fresh thing among us. And Lord, that we would be prepared for your coming. We pray that you would speak to our hearts. We're your children. Lord, I pray that you would just draw us closer. And Lord, that we would have a desire to draw closer and not drift away. Help us to keep our eyes on you and to be prepared when you come again. Give you praise and glory and honor for all that you do as you send us out into this world to live our lives part of the kingdom of God. Build your kingdom for your glory.